All right. Welcome back to the Realennials. I'm Pat.
I'm Ruby.
And I'm Derrick.
Oh, nice.
Thanks, Derrick, for being on the show today. How you doing?
I'm good. Just chilling.
We're excited to have you.
I'm excited to be here.
Are you as tired as we are?
I am very tired.
What did you do last night?
I went to a friend's house and we had quite a bit of cheese and wine and it was delicious.
Oh, nice.
What kind of cheese?
Maybe too much wine. A variety of cheeses.
Oh, shit.
So at Whole Foods now, there is a tiny little basket that they keep on their cheese fridge.
Yeah.
That's just full of remnants. So like all of the blocks that have like weird little sections and stuff. And so you can buy these tiny little pieces of cheese between like $1, $3, where otherwise you'd be paying like $15 for this piece of cheese that you don't know you're gonna like. And so we just buy a bunch of those and
nice.
Eat them.
We didn't realize it was First Fridays yesterday until we were driving around and noticed how much activity was going on around the city.
Really?
Was this a First Fridays situation?
Nope.
Or this just was, like a Friday night situation?
This was a Friday night avoiding the cold of First Fridays situation.
Yeah, there was things happening around town, but we recorded last night. We had some really cool musical guests come in.
That's awesome.
I know.
Where are you from?
I'm from Kansas City, so I'm from Peculiar, Missouri. Grew up there.
We've talked about this.
Yeah. I generally don't talk about it, but like might as well. so grew up in the metro. Family's all from here. Went to school at UMKC. Studied architecture for 2 years there. And then after that, transferred to Savannah College of Art and Design in Savannah,
nice.
Georgia. So I studied architecture and design for sustainability there, and it overall is a very different place than Kansas City,
mm-hmm.
as you can imagine. It's an interesting place. Like, first of all, going from UMKC to an art school is a very different change.
That's a good art school too.
Yeah, I had a great time there. I met some of the most talented people that I know there today, and who are all doing like really great work in all of their fields. And I think the thing that was most exciting about being there was I got to see all sorts of creative fields that I didn't even know existed. So I think prior to going to art school, I didn't have an understanding that like motion graphics could be its own field of study, or fiber art was different from fashion design, and that even within that major, there could be so many different tracks. And so you get to know a lot of people who have very particular interests, mm-hmm. and it's exciting to see what drives people and the type of things that make people who are illustrators or people who are industrial designers, all those things that make them excited about what they do. And I think that, for me, that's exciting, is to see what other people are excited about.
So that's your title, industrial design?
No, sorry. I studied architecture. The title at my current job at Dimensional Innovations is a lead designer. And our team is a combination of various designers, so architectural designers, interior, industrial, and graphic designers.
Oh, nice. Okay.
So we all work together. So we all share the title designer at varying tiers, but most everyone's practice came from one particular focus. Okay. So I don't practice traditional architecture in, I guess, the conventional sense of a more standard architectural mm-hmm. firm. Our primary focus is activating or sort of creating branded spaces or exhibits within existing buildings, facilities, sometimes in partnership with other architecture firms.
What's an example of something like that?
So a good example is Jay Rieger whiskey. Yeah. So they're here in Kansas City. And they came to us probably a year and a half ago. They are undergoing a pretty extensive renovation of a historic building and expansion. And so one of the things that they came to us for was they, as a brand, they started in the late 1800s and kind of continued. Yeah, they produced liquor for a long time up until Prohibition. And so there's a lot of really rich history to that name and to the whiskey that they were producing. And then once Prohibition happened, they shut down. So they got, they sort of left liquor altogether and got into other
they quote unquote shut down.
No, they actually shut it down. There were other people who continued to operate and make whiskey or other liquors, but they left, they switched, they got into banking and different fields. But then a few years ago, they sort of restarted the distillery. And one of the things that they wanted to do with this renovation was take all of the history of that family and that brand and then tell it through a series of exhibits that are also telling the history of Kansas City at the same time. Mm, nice. So, like, the building that they're in used to be a beer brewery, so it was a bottling plant for the Heim Brewery, which also closed during Prohibition. So they're renovating this beautiful building that was built in the early 1900s. And kind of the goal for them is not just telling the story of who Rieger is as a brand, but kind of giving some context to all of the things that were happening in Kansas City during the time of it's sort of this whole liquor market came into play, like basically in the West Bottoms. And at the same time, women's rights activists in Kansas were fighting for prohibition. And so there was this interesting dichotomy between Kansas, where alcohol was prohibited before it was throughout the rest of the U.S., and it's very fascinating because there are so many things that you're like, I really don't have any idea why prohibition happened. And it actually happened a lot because, like, there were most of the time, like when you think about alcoholism, it was generally men of families were getting super drunk, spending all of their money. And that's sort of how the women's suffrage movement kind of came about in the U.S. was women fighting for their rights. And part of that was prohibition and the effects of prohibition. So the West Bottoms being right on the state line was actually like, they called it like the wettest street in the world or the wettest block in the world, because in Missouri there were basically no restrictions on liquor, but you cross the street and you couldn't get any alcohol at all.
Interesting.
So there's a lot of history regarding some of those things that really make the Kansas City distilling and brewing culture pretty unique. And so we want to tell those stories because they're important to who their brand has become today and just kind of give some insight as to why beer and brewing, distilling culture is kind of had a resurgence in KC.
That's interesting to have to focus and incorporate like all that historical aspect into design. So you studied architecture.
Yeah.
So can you design a building?
The answer is we don't know yet.
Okay, that's a loaded question. Technically, from a legal standpoint, no, I cannot
legally design a
building.
That's the answer.
So the track to become an architect is fairly complicated. Generally speaking, you have to have a master's in architecture, a specific program for a master's in architecture. And after that, you go through a series of internship hours where you have to get a minimum number of hours in a variety of different fields, whether that be construction administration or like design or project management. So there's all sorts of things that you sort of have to qualify for and
be. Can you design a tiny home?
I see why you're asking these questions.
I can do design for you. Yes, I can design a space for you. Can I sign it and make sure that it gets approved by the city? That is
up in the air.
Can you ghostwrite architecture plans?
Do they do that? Is that a
thing? Oh yeah, that's definitely a thing. I mean, generally speaking, for the most part, within any architecture firm, there are people who are not licensed architects doing the drawings and doing the design work, and then it goes to an architect
and they just
who has final sign off.
How much of your design work have you actually followed all the way through? So you just wrote it up, designed it, planned it, got the materials and got the tools and built something yourself?
So I have two answers to that question. The direct answer to your question about building yourself is no. I think I've built a couple things, like a lamp and a table, and then projects for school and things like that. But from a career perspective, my company is a design build firm. All of our work, we sort of start at the very beginning, sort of a discovery phase with our clients to sort of get to know them. And then we will proceed all the way through the design process.
They make it there.
And then eventually we'll hand it off to our engineering department. They'll create shop drawings, and then our fabricators will build it. We'll go out and install it. So we really do have constant connection with the client and with all of the things that are being installed throughout the entire process.
So you can walk over and see the progress of something being made that you designed and wait, you didn't.
And then
that.
Yeah, exactly. Which some people love and some people hate.
Yeah, right.
Because you can get real particular really quick, but I think our clients generally expect you to know who they are and to know that the final outcome is reflecting their vision. So
How did you choose architecture? Did you always know that you were going to go into architecture? Because I, too, once wanted to be an architect. And then I took some drafting classes, and I was like, okay, this is not for me.
So I did. I sort of discovered it through a process of elimination. My dad has worked in construction my whole life. My mom has worked at an engineering firm, although he's not an engineer. And so there's always been some sort of loose tie into, the building trade industry. Mm-hmm. And so, as a kid, I remember going to visit some the renovation of Union Station and all sorts of different pretty prominent projects in KC, just because my dad was working on them. So I was always sort of around this construction environment. Excuse me. And so there was some influence there, and then. My mom being at an engineering firm, there were some just sort of natural inclinations toward being interested in it and interested in the systems and that kind of thing.
How were you with Legos?
I did not use Legos. I used Kinex.
Interesting.
Oh, I was definitely a Kinex kid. I would.
Those are the little wheels with the.
Yeah. And so all of the gears that sort of work together, and then you can add motors and all sorts of things. And that was I liked.
Early indicator.
Yeah, definitely. So I was around engineering and had some interest in it. And in tandem, when I got into middle school and high school, I was really interested in journalism. And so I started getting into newspaper and in yearbook, newspaper particularly. And then started sort of down this graphic design track. And I never saw that as a path I would want. It was just something that I enjoyed doing. And in high school, a lot of local engineering firms offer these things called explorer posts, which are where they bring high schoolers in and show them what the various engineering tracks look like and what the field is like. And I remember particularly one day at one of these posts, the context of this is a conference room of 70 kids between any age between middle school and high school. And And there was an engineer there trying to get us to solve this equation for measuring like hydraulic pressure or something. And I remember like the moment where I was like, I knew this wasn't for me, was when they had us use this equation and the unit of measurement was referred to as a slug. Mm. And I had no idea what it meant. I did not understand it. It just made me sort of angry because I was like, I don't get what you're trying to tell me to do. I was like, I don't want to do this. And so I knew like
you crossed that one off the list.
Engineering was like, I am not interested in this. And so around that time, like I was getting more into graphic design and I started to look at, as I was getting closer to college, started to look at what fields might be right. And architecture was sort of, like I said, a process of elimination because there were things like, say I had gone to school and studied graphic design, it would have been a much harder jump for me after college to get to do architecture work.
Mm, yeah.
But studying architecture allowed me some of the abilities to do graphic design and industrial design in addition to architecture. So it felt like the least exclusive option,
nice.
Where I got to learn kind of about all of these various fields and the way that they influence design without necessarily committing to one specific thing.
You could kind of combine them all with architecture.
Yeah, I think to an extent.
We're going to talk about that when we come back from the break. Guys, you're listening to the Realennials, and we'll be back after this break.
All right, welcome back to the show. I'm Pat.
I'm Ruby.
You're tuned into the Realennials, and we're here with our guest, Derrick. Thanks for being here.
Thank you.
So we were just talking about how you chose architecture. And so we ended basically in high school when you chose to go to UMKC. So you went to UMKC, and did you figure out there, okay, this is for sure what I want to be doing? And then that's when you scaled it up to go to the, Savannah?
College of Art and Design. So... UMKC was a fantastic school to study architecture at. It's a pretty small program, so I think that gives you a lot of opportunities to grow directly with your professors and mentors and things like that. And it was a very, very rigorous program. And at UMKC, you start right out in your architecture classes when you're a freshman.
Oh, nice.
So you dive right in.
Oh, wow. So
you do have some sort of like gen ed classes that you're taking at the same time, but for the most part, you are like straight into studio classes.
Can you go check out in the hallway? See what's going on out there?
So you're straight into those architecture classes as soon as you get in.
Yeah. And so the way the UMKC program works is Missouri doesn't have a public architecture degree program at any of its universities.
Oh.
So UMKC offers a reciprocal program with KU and K-State where you could do 2 years at UMKC. Then you can go to KU or K-State and get in-state tuition if you're from Missouri. So I did the 2 years at UMKC, really liked it, but was kind of feeling like I didn't want to necessarily follow the same program. I also didn't want to move to Manhattan,
Kansas.
Nobody
wants to move to Manhattan, Kansas.
So I kind of went out on a limb and thought, like, I'm gonna look at some other schools. When I was looking at schools in high school, I'd kind of looked into SCAD, into Rhode Island School of Design, just sort of like aspirationally.
Yeah.
And never really like committed to them at all, never applied or anything, and sort of like went to UMKC and just did that because I didn't really do as much research or plan as much as I should have. Mm-hmm. But I really enjoyed the UMKC program. And then when I got to the end of my 2 years, I was like, I have to make a move regardless. And if I'm going to make one, I want it to be for a program that I am sort of dead set on. And so I applied to SCAD, sort of worked with them through the transfer process, and was able to transfer right into my junior year, which shaved off a lot of money for skipping my first 2 years at an art school.
Yeah.
And then gave me some really new, exciting opportunities when I got there, because the program couldn't be more different from what UMKC was.
Interesting.
Well, that's fun. That's great that you got both of those experiences.
Yes. I think that was like, I wouldn't do it over. I think the UMKC program that I was taught through was incredibly pragmatic and taught me the rudiments really, really well. Mm-hmm. Whether that be like hand drawing with pencils or like model making. We were not really allowed to use computers throughout all of our work, so it was all basically done by hand. It was drawn by hand, it was modeled by hand. And like I said, from their ideology was very pragmatic, and it was about building functional spaces. And then I got to Savannah, and it was like, it was 100% totally, not even that. It was, I remember my first studio, when I got there, one of the professor asked me to come up with a few concepts. It's like right when I get there. And so normally my process would be like, I would draw some stuff in a floor plan, then build this little model about the various different shapes and how they relate to one another. Mm. And then I go back for my review, and she's like, this is totally wrong. I was like, I don't understand. This I've worked really hard on this. She was like, when I'm talking about concepts, I mean like, make me a diagram or a model of like the light coming through the trees or different things like that. And I'm like, oh, this is gonna be a lot harder than I thought it was.
Yeah. You're like, ooh, more abstract.
But I'm glad that I had both of those things, because there were a lot of my colleagues at SCAD that didn't necessarily, that knew a lot of stuff and were incredibly talented conceptual thinkers, mm-hmm. but didn't necessarily have those rudimentary skills that allow you to make like a really nice model or mm-hmm. really nice hand drawings. Obviously there were students who could do those things, but I think as a whole, there was this part of it that was lacking that UMKC really prepped me really well for.
When did you pick up photography?
Probably about 4 or 5 years ago. A friend of mine got a minor in photography, and his mom used to own a photo studio when he was a kid. And so he always had like a series of film cameras that he was carrying around. And I knew nothing about photography. I like never really owned a camera.
Even when you were doing like journalism stuff in high school?
I mean, I would like shoot a little bit, but like, it's high school.
That had
like,
to be film back then too, right? When you were in high school?
No, it was digital. It was digital at the time.
How old are you?
I'm 27, so.
Oh, you're young.
Okay. Okay, a few years.
So it was digital. After me, I guess. But for the most part, I wasn't really shooting. I would shoot occasionally, but nothing artistic. It was like, go take pictures of the cheerleaders or get the kids in the band class, like stuff like that. And so, after college, a friend of mine, he was shooting film photography, and I was kind of traveling with him, and I was like, I don't know anything about this, and that's kind of interesting to me. And so, excuse me, I was really interested in film photography particularly, because with digital camera, you can kind of shoot forever.
Yeah.
And you like take 200 pictures and you cross your fingers that three of them are good. Mm-hmm. Film photography is 100% different.
I love it.
It is completely about trusting that you have everything right and that you're committed to this shot. And if you don't get it, you don't get it, because you can't afford to take 20 pictures of the same thing.
You have to be more mindful too when you're doing it. You have to make sure.
So I started out shooting film exclusively. I bought a Canon AE-1 from a guy on Craigslist and went super deep into it really quick. Just love the sort of like the waiting part of it is, like I said, the committing to a shot and then having no idea if you're going to get it and then seeing what the final result is. And that is a very, the process of doing that leaves a lot of risk, I guess, and that is kind of enticing. But then, tragically, like, the in my opinion, the best developer here in Kansas City and most affordable, closed.
Oh, no.
Crick Camera closed couple of years ago, and it made it increasingly difficult to get quality film developed at an affordable price. And so at that point, after I had probably sinked a couple grand into developing pictures over a few years, I was like, I think it's time to make a switch to digital.
Interesting.
So did you ever develop your own film?
No, I didn't. I have done it a little bit. Like, a friend of mine let me in UMKC's lab and we were able to do it there, but even there, I believe they only process black and white. Mm-hmm. So, and then you start getting into color, you're talking about more and more chemicals, that it's just like the opportunities for error just increase exponentially.
I know, on the photos that you were so mindful to take.
Right. Yes, exactly.
And then you're like, oh, I just ruined a whole film.
Exactly. So no, I haven't really developed my own, and I would love to try, but it's sort of one of those things. You really need the proper setup to do it right.
I think developing my own film, I got really into photography in high school. Developing my own film is what made me really fall in love with it, because it is the process of actually seeing it. You have to be in there, like, in the dark, and you have to, like, feel what you're doing, and then you have to wait a little bit, and then you get to see your negatives, and you're like, oh, that one's dope. But then you don't know, because you have to enlarge it, and then you go enlarge it.
Yeah, when you're looking at it at this size, you're like, oh, this is going to be great. Yeah. And then you get it, and you're like, wow, that was out of focus.
Wow, this is all fuzzy, the entire thing.
Yeah. As a video editor, the thought excites me to, like, cut up a bunch of reels and meticulously line them up and spending hours and hours.
Oh, like films?
I'm just kidding. That sounds terrible. That sounds like the worst thing ever. I can't believe people did that. Thank God they did, because movies are awesome.
Imagine if we would have been born back in those days. You might have been still wearing those same glasses.
Is, like, the thing is, right.
Discovered the formula.
Modern film producers are increasingly getting back into film. I mean, video producers are getting increasingly back into film because it offers something that digital can't capture to some extent. There is a certain nuance that film allows you to bring to a
Quentin
picture.
Quentin Tarantino single-handedly kept the last film producing company alive.
Yeah.
By, I think, investing buying like $1 million of their stock or something like that. He was able to keep them open effectively, because they were on the verge of closing.
Yeah,
and like taking away film from the film industry entirely. Yeah.
And now, I mean, Kodak just released, like last year, they released a brand new Super 8 camera, so that you can now go out and shoot on tiny little 8mm film. But there's an increasing market for it. It's obviously still can be fairly cost prohibitive for somebody who's just trying to do it as a hobby, but increasingly, I think more and more directors are starting to use it for artistic and more specialty short films, things like that.
So, when you started photography, what was the subject matter that you liked to shoot? Because I know right now you're into portraitures, right? Portraiture.
I think that's a good question.
Were you just shooting everything at that point in time?
Yeah, it started as a hobby, and I think throughout architecture school, learned to develop an eye for things. And so it was really just more kind of being perceptive of surroundings and being able to say, like, of all of the noise of everything, there's something right here that's interesting mm-hmm. in capturing that. And so I did that for quite a while, and so that's generally doesn't include people as subjects. But then more and more, like as I just started taking pictures of my friends and things like that, I started to realize like there's a certain amount of emotion that you can start to capture in mm-hmm. a picture that you can't necessarily capture in a static subject.
Do you follow Damon Baker on Instagram?
Damon Baker.
I don't know if I do.
You should check him out.
He's okay. Probably, I follow a lot of people. I'm not sure.
I didn't really realize how much I like portrait photography until I saw your page. And then I happened to... He like came up in my suggested or something. But he does black and white. He's very actually famous. He does a lot of celebrities. And it's amazing, his shots.
Follow.
I think one of my... I remember particularly where I got interested in it actually was... But didn't do any act on it at all was when I was studying at UMKC, the Nelson had... They generally have a series of lectures, but they had one in particular of this photographer, Fazal Sheikh. And he did a series of portraits... primarily of children, mm-hmm. I want to say like in, I want to say Libya, I'm not certain on that, but so he came and did a lecture about his process and why he shot those portraits. And I mean, these are beautiful medium and large format portraits that mm-hmm. the depth and the quality of them is just immaculate. And then they're also like these child subjects that are generally in some sort of like, religious wear, whether that be headwear or something like that. Yeah. And so he captured these subjects really well, and that was an instance where I saw portraiture as something different from what I imagined it was mm-hmm. and kind of got me interested in it. And they still have a few pieces of his sort of in their collection at the Nelson that they'll occasionally bring out. And I think they sell like books on his work, but he definitely, seeing him speak and kind of show his process was definitely eye-opening for me.
Awesome. Well, we will hear more about Derrick when we come back from the break.
Back to the Realennials. I'm Ruby.
I'm Pat.
And we're still here with Derrick. And we were just talking about photography. And we're getting some of your influences. Who's an influence or an inspiration in photography for you right now?
Can I pause? I want to be able to answer that question with like actual names.
Oh, okay.
I'm sorry.
Did you bring props?
He brings out a big picture.
I do have people that I follow, but like I don't want to like this dude. Sorry.
Oh, you're fine. No worries. We're keeping this in, by the way.
Yeah.
Oh, great. Okay, it's cool. Gonna be. I didn't realize that's how this worked. Is this? Shoot.
I mean, maybe not for the radio, but definitely for the video.
So. I would say for the most part, I follow
is it people that do portraiture, or are you influenced by other types of photography?
No, I'd say for the most part, I'm looking for, when I am following an artist, I'm looking for a distinctive eye mm-hmm. and, or it's some sort of something about their work that is distinctive. Sometimes that's their subjects. Sometimes mm-hmm. that's their shooting style. Mm-hmm. Sometimes that's the way they edit mm-hmm. their portraits. And for the most part, I'm looking for somebody who's done something, doing something out of the norm. I think there are, like, one photographer I think of in particular, Ryan Pfluger, is, I think, a really talented photographer who is increasingly more into portraits, but I think, I can't speak for his history, but I think I probably started following from more of his static kind of, his static work, either whether that be landscapes or just sort of the banal, like, realness of the world, I guess.
Like more still life sort of
thing. Yeah, yeah. But for the most part, I would say I'm looking for a distinctive eye, and I generally try and follow people who other designers are following. I think,
oh, nice.
Especially in the age of, yeah, like Instagram and just YouTube, it's easy to get to be more caught on like particular channels of people. Mm-hmm. And so you follow like these curated pages of somebody of posting these things. And I think you only see so much when you're following these curated pages, that really what you should be doing is finding the photographers and the directors who are actually making those portraits and those pictures and those videos themselves. Because then you also get a chance to see the things that they're liking.
Mm-hmm. And what's influencing them, giving yes. them inspiration.
I think the best tool for this, at least in terms of video, is Vimeo, not just because of it's a good company, but because it allows you to see the things that other directors are watching and liking. Mm-hmm. And so you really get a sense of what is actually quality content, because it's just you're seeing what other people are working on. It's not being aggregated for you. It's not being curated by some organization, yeah, or like some magazine. It's literally just people who like watching or looking at things and sharing those things that they like.
Yeah.
If that makes sense.
It's the stuff that they found in the rabbit hole that they went down. They're like, yes. Oh, somehow I got to this thing and it influenced me.
Right. And I think, yeah, whether it's a designer or a photographer or whatever, I think the way to learn the most about them is to go directly into their work, to look at their website, and to just sort of dive in and see what their influences are. And then even just see like who their friends are and who they're following, because more likely than not, like, they're also really talented.
What do you feel like the creative scene is like here in Kansas City? Just in general, like your friends that are also doing creative things in photography, if you have any friends, or podcasting, video.
I would say two things. I am a harsh critic, but I think that increasingly there are more artists who have been on the periphery of art in Kansas City that are becoming a little bit more, I don't want to say mainstream, prominent, mm-hmm. because their work is different. I think kind of between, I think kind of between 2010 and 2016, 17, there was sort of this resurgence of the maker in Kansas City and maker mm-hmm. culture. And I think that's a really good thing. But I think that also has created this culture of everyone copying each other and sort of making the same things. And like, I can only do so many more t-shirt companies. Mm. Like, I really don't.
I mean, if you put Kansas City on a t-shirt, right. it's going to sell.
It's going to sell. And that's we love that's our great show. For the people who are selling t-shirts.
Is that a reminder to cancel the appointment with the t-shirt company?
But I have been seeing kind of designers and artists trying to break the norm, mm-hmm. Which I think is exciting. And I think there are a few more institutions now willing to kind of cater and help cultivate that. I think like Kansas City, the art scene has evolved pretty substantially. I think before it used to be a lot of the same thing. And it was the people who've been in the industry for years and years, just the only ones able to get shows and to make work. And I think with millennials now starting to have a little bit more means to create the work that they want to create, you're starting to see some shifts in what people are producing and what the culture of Kansas City is. And I think that like there are galleries and curators that are starting to change the dialogue. I think like the Haw Contemporary is doing things in their galleries that are unlike anything other galleries are doing. And I think even the Nelson Atkins has started to see that they need to change the way that Kansas Cityans dialogue with art and the way that people interact with it and the things that they can offer to the community.
Have you thought about doing any type of industrial art, like pieces, the stuff that gets put out on corners?
Installation art.
I mean, I don't know if you're even interested in that, but it seems like your skill set would lend to something like that.
Well, I had a question similar to that, if I can piggyback off that question. Do you see any spaces that are doing a really good like experiential art where you would go and it's not just you're seeing something, but you're experiencing something at the same time? Because I feel like that goes along with what you do at your job. Yeah. You guys are creating that more for a brand, not really for like, right, you know, an artistic experience. But is there anywhere that people maybe in town or that you have traveled to that has a good, like, well-made experience of art? Or an art piece itself?
That's an interesting question. I would say overall, the culture of art and culture of entertainment in general has shifted to the experience. Mm-hmm. And so I do think increasingly art is becoming less of a particular piece and more of a particular environment. And I think galleries here, galleries worldwide, are learning that they have to change their offerings in that people do want to show up at a gallery and have an experience that they've never had before. There are small galleries here in KC, like Front Space, Plug Projects, that are doing things, doing sort of unconventional things that are beyond, like I said, just putting up particular pieces.
Mm-hmm. Or like the open spaces situation that happened for an entire month.
Open spaces was 10 weeks.
Yeah.
A really long time. and I think it is starting to change. Overall, I would say that the culture around what it means to experience art is changing, and consumers of art have the sort of expectations that the art experience needs to evolve with all of the other experiences that are changing. Does that answer your question?
You, kind of. You are answering my question. I've been thinking while you've been talking, you have the skill set to do like a big installation piece. Like it, by just being able to, you know, conceptualize and then, like, put it on paper.
I have plenty of ideas. I have thousands of ideas.
For an installation?
For any kind of installation. Oh, I could tell you my ideas for doing something in an alley in the crossroads. Or there are, like, all sorts of different things that I have ideas for. But, like, I wouldn't necessarily call myself an artist per se. I would say I am most thrilled and challenged by being able to work with other really talented people and to push their vision and their goals further. So I would say the answer to your question of like, have I done installation art specifically, or would I like do a particular piece? I would say like, as one person, no, I don't know that I would do that solely. But like as a team or with a particular artist or a group of artists, that would be something that would be incredibly exciting to do.
Oh, that's exciting because I have some ideas too.
Okay,
stay perfect. Tuned, y'all. I really do. I love installation art. I studied fine art in college. Those were my first 2 years. And my installation art classes were my favorite by far.
Yeah.
I did a lot of studying on Andy Goldsworthy. He's a natural.
That sounds so made up.
Yeah. No, it's true. It's real. Andy Goldsworthy. Oof, I might have messed that up. But anyways, he's more of he goes into nature and mm-hmm. makes an installation in nature, and the only proof of it is the photograph of it.
Yeah.
And then he lets it go into nature.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. There was a documentary about him that came out last year. They screened it at the Tivoli for a little while.
Oh, yes. I'm pretty sure. Yes. He was very inspirational to me when I was studying that. But then I switched and went a completely different
route. Yeah. I think that it's interesting because obviously, like, art has changed and you do have more of these, I don't want to say performative, but site-specific pieces that people are making, whether they're temporary activations or
permanent.
That one thing yeah. that you mentioned where he makes it, he takes a picture and it washes away. But there are other instances where people are creating art that sort of lives out in a landscape or in a desert, and you sort of drive up and experience it.
Like the Prada Marfa?
Like, exactly. Like Marfa, Desert X out in Coachella Valley, like this is an instance of that. But it's one of those things. It's sort of a challenge. Do you only make art so that it's documented? Like, mm-hmm. as an artist, mm-hmm. do you want your only role in the art to make something so that somebody photographs it? I don't know. Like, that's an interesting challenge.
That's an interesting question, actually, because as an artist, I've made things and I've made projects that like I made for myself and
right.
mm-hmm. are like unreleased, and I'm still very happy with them as a project. And it's interesting in the culture of entertainment, right? Because
yeah.
you want to be creative and you want to be, I'm sure you experience similar things too in your work where you have a degree of autonomy in terms of creativity. But there's monetary implications and commercial implications about the direction you want to go. So it's kind
right.
of, it kind of limits your creativity, so to speak. But it's interesting to analyze that like spectrum of artists who are just out there. They don't work. They live off a trust fund. They can make art, whatever.
Right.
And it's like, do they make it? For what purpose, why, how
right.
do they want to get it out, or does it matter? Do they
yeah.
just make 100 paintings that sit in a warehouse for themselves? Have you seen Jim Carrey's paintings? They're actually
I have seen them, and they're pretty great.
Anyways, we're running out of time here, but thank you so much, Derrick, for
yeah, it was great
coming.
Having you.
Yeah, thanks.
I went
Appreciate
on a little
it.
Tangent right there. We're the Realennials. Check us out online, on all social media. Hit us up, just an email at therealennials@gmail.com. Derrick, where can people find you at? Do you want people to find you?
Instagram, Derrick Riley, DerrickRiley.
Hey.
Yeah, that's probably the easiest.
All right. Well, I'm Pat.
I'm Ruby. Thanks for joining us.
We'll see you next time.
Bye.
You talk, it's something about you, girl. about you. Something about you. Something about you, girl. Something about the way. Something about you and the things that you do. Something about you. Something about the things you do. The things you do to me. Something about you. Something about you, girl. Something about the way. Something about you. Something about you. Something about you, girl. Something about you, girl. Something about the way.